And if you don't know him, I invite you to get to know the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, the one who wiped my tears and picked me up from the miry clay, the one who dusted me off in all my sin and dirt and said, daughter, you are beautiful and worthy. Come, I have a place for you in my house. And baby, you don't even have to be perfect. You don't have to be clean. You can come just as unfinished as you are and be a leader in my church. Disclaimer, let's go back to the disclaimer, because y'all, like, I'm trying to prepare y'all for me and who I am in all my glory. I just hope y'all are ready. So Pastor Brenton gave an amazing word last night. He literally preached three of my sermons in the one that he preached, and I was like, Lord, it is a good thing I did not prepare until I listened to him, because he literally, and I was just like, God, he said it all. And God said, yes, he said it all in his way. Now I need you to say it again in your way.
Amen. Amen.
So I'm going to say it again. And I like it. Keep the amens coming, because sometimes I get really, really quiet when I preach. So there are three characters in this story. We are in 1 Samuel 3, 1 to 20. And if I'm an educator, you might want to take notes. I promise you what I'm going to say, you might need to reflect it and go back. And like Pastor Brenton told you last night, I'm going to tell you, go home and check me.
Right.
Y'all better not be listening to these TikTok preachers and these Instagram ministers, or even the ministers that come up to your pulpits without checking them. Because I tell the church, y'all better check me. And I've had, like, you know, sometimes I'm old. I'm 42 years old. Yes, I am. And sometimes I get the characters mixed up, right? The names in my head. And my congregation, you know what they do? They check me and they correct me, as they should. So y'all better go home and check me. So there's three characters in this story. We have Eli. Somebody say Eli.
Eli.
We have Samuel. Somebody say Samuel.
Samuel.
And then we have God. Somebody say God.
God.
There are three concepts that really jumped out to me at this scriptures that I want to introduce to you tonight, that is intricately and intimately intertwined into the three characters. Eli, Samuel, God. The three concept is this: spiritually mature in. Two, the call or the calling. Three, the question of called for what? Spiritually mature ring. Notice I didn't say spiritually matured. The call or calling. And the question of called for what? I would like to submit that these three things play an important role. You don't believe me? Great. I'm happy. I don't want you to believe anything I say. Let me prove it to you. Eli was a devoted high priest who served Israel as judge for 40 years. He is from the descendant of the house of Aaron. This is the most holy tribe of the 12 tribes of Israel. Eli was the priest who engaged with Hannah when she was desperate for a child. Mm-hmm. I have a whole sermon on that. It's really good. If you follow us on Reimagine, go listen to it. The son of Samuel, right? The son Samuel is the son from Hannah, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Now, I would consider Eli to be a spiritually maturing believer.
Right.
Notice I did not say a spiritual matured believer. Some may disagree with that premise of maturing. Some may also disagree that maturity is considered to be based on age and experience.
Right. Right.
I disagree. disagree with the concept. Sit down. Many believe that when you are mature, it's because you have lived on the planet for a really long time and have gone through a lot of experiences, and because you've been saved for 30 years plus, you are now an expert on all things holy and spiritual. The definition of spiritually mature in ING is described as 1, a process of growing in one's relationship with God and is not limited to a specific age. Is not limited to a specific age.
Right.
2, it's an ongoing process that Christians begin after salvation with the goal of becoming more like Jesus Christ.
Alright.
3, according to the Apostle Paul, spiritually maturing is not completed until the end of life. So that means that you are not considered to be spiritual mature in all of your glory, no matter how old you are and no matter how long you have served Christ. Amen.
Amen.
We are all mature in, including me. I'm the chief sinner. A lot of people like to run around churches believing that they are spiritually mature and therefore spiritual authorities. That has caused, because they have been in the church the 30, the 40, the 50 years. Now, I myself have been saved for 30 years. I've been walking with God for 30 years. Was it perfect? And I promise you, in that 30 years, I've met some teenagers and young adults that have been more spiritually matured than some of the 60, 70, 80, and 100-year-old people sitting in the pews. I told y'all, y'all ain't gotta like me. This is not my home church. I'm gonna give it the way God gave it to me, and then I'm gonna go home. Why? Better yet, I've been saved 30 years, and I'm still being processed, I'm still learning, I'm still growing, I'm still being corrected by God every single day, and I'm still moving from glory to glory to glory in my process of maturing. Eli was spiritually maturing. How can we tell? Let's look at verse 8 and 9. Can we put those up? When Eli, at the time, the Lord called Samuel, and Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me?" Then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, "Go and lay down, and if he calls you, say, 'Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and laid down in his place. Can I submit to you that Eli recognized that God was calling Samuel? Right. And Eli told Samuel exactly what to do and exactly how to do it.
Right.
He didn't say, "Well, you're not old enough. Sit down and wait."
Uh-oh. Ouch.
He didn't say, "Well, you're only 14, you can't really pray lead priest team because, you know." He didn't say that. What did he say? He said, "Go back, lay down, and listen to what God is saying to you." Do we have any Elis in the house? Because if you are over 25 and you are at a youth facility, I would submit to you that you are positioned to be an Eli in this house.
Amen.
That God is positioning you to advocate for for the young people in this house to go to bat for them when they need you to go to bat for them, to surround them when they need to be surrounded, to pray for them when they need to be prayed for, to anoint them when they need to be anointed, to speak a word of encouragement to them when they need to be encouraged. I would submit to you that God has placed some Eli's in the house right now to pray up the generation that is now. Have you known that you are a person who is spiritually maturing? Notice I didn't say a leader. I'm coming for that. I'm coming for y'all too. I hope y'all ready for me. Because I come 100. How do you know that you're a maturing Christian? Let's go to the scripture, because I am a scriptural person. And I use the scriptures to base everything I teach. I don't come with my opinions, because Melissa Allison Peters in all of her glory means nothing and knows nothing. But let's take it to the Word of God. Galatians 5:22 and 23 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is
love,
joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against these things there are no such law. How do you know you're spiritually maturing? Do you love on people? Or do you love a good piece of gossip? Do you show self-control by praying for people instead of passing along the information when it comes to you? This is self-reflection, people. Sometimes we can't say amen. Sometimes it is just ouch. Do you find joy in life, or are you one of those mean and surly Christians? I say that because, listen, I was right along with you for most of my life. I encountered Jesus in my crisis moment at 30 years old. Before that, you looked at me the wrong way, and I would tell you who you are, how you got there, up and down, where you need to go, and how you should get there in the name of Jesus, and then walk away and pray for you. You could ask anybody. I was mean and angry, but I was gifted and called. Do you have patience with people, especially young people, who are still finding themselves and figuring out who they are? Or do you go around saying things like, I don't know why these young people can't get their lives together. Why they always playing with God? Lest you forget when you were a teenager. Because I love hearing y'all stories when y'all really get real about what y'all did and how you did it. In the house of God. Don't play with me. Spiritually mature. We are able to tell by your
fruits.
You should be able to tell my life by my fruits. Eli was spiritually maturing because his fruit was good. Point two, let's move to Samuel and this idea of calling, and I promise you I'm about to destroy all y'all Christians in the house right now. If you had been in the church for more than 30 years, I apologize in advance, but God gave it to me, and just like he gave it to me, I'm going to give it to you. Preachers, when they preach this passage of scriptures, always preach. And in this moment that God calls Samuel and declares, Samuel, you are going to be a great prophet. Samuel called God, I mean, God called Samuel to be a prophet.
Right.
Now, Samuel did turn out to be a prophet. But show me in the scripture where God called Samuel to be a prophet. Show me the verse where God called Samuel to be a prophet. I'll wait. Nobody? What did God call Samuel? What did God do after he called Samuel? May I submit to you that God didn't call him in this passage to be a prophet? The Bible doesn't say that. The scripture doesn't say that. Let's go to verse 10 to 19, but I'm going to pick out specific verses, right? Where it says, now the Lord said to Samuel, see, I'm about to do something in the house of Israel that will make the ears of the people who hear tingle. And God begins to do what? What does God begin to do with Samuel? Tell him what he's going to do. God begins to speak to Samuel. God, at this point, doesn't call Samuel and say, you are going to be a prophet. He says, hey, come. Let me tell you what's in my inner workings of my mind and heart. Let me tell you, Samuel, what I'm going to do in the future. God calls Samuel to relationship. I just destroyed years and years of your theology right there. He didn't call him to be a prophet. If we go down to verse 19, it says, is it 19? Go to verse 18. Wait. 18. So Samuel told him everything, meaning Eli, and hid nothing from him. And Eli said, the Lord is good. Let him do what's good in his eyes. And the Lord said to Samuel, as he grew up, and he let none of Samuel's word fall to the ground. God called Samuel to relationship, not a prophet. Verse 20. And all of Israel from Dan to Beersheba recognized that Samuel was attested as a
prophet.
Who recognized that he was a prophet? The people. The people. The people around recognized what God had gifted him with. But God didn't call him to be a prophet. He called him to relationship. Let me, I don't play with the word of God. Let me show you something else. In modern history, the church has somehow began to associate the calling of God, and they mixed up the calling with the gifting and the offices that we hold. So now people go around saying, I want you to be what God has called you to be.
Right.
And when they say that, they're thinking something like this. Ephesians 4, 11 and 12. Ephesians 4, 11 and 12. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and some teachers for the perfecting of the saints and the work of the ministry for the edifying of the body of 90% of the people. Pastor Brenton and I do a lot of crisis ministry for people who are young adults and teenagers. That means that we get a lot of midnight phone calls, 2 and 3 and 4 o'clock in the morning, phone calls of people who are on the verge of committing suicide. people who are in a very dark place and are in crisis moments. And it's not strange for us to leave the house to go minister to someone or to be on the phone in the bathroom talking and praying with people, because people are desperate and in need, and we're living in a society that's full of darkness and there's no light showing up. Why? Because your light is in your church and you're fighting in the church while the world is waiting out there to be lit. Of the people I speak to are struggling with this concept. I don't know what God called me to be. I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing with my life. I don't know my purpose. I don't know what my calling is. After Jesus Christ, right? After Jesus Christ came, here was his great commission. We're Nazarene, we should know it. Matthew 28, 18 and 20. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. My opinion and my issues of church is that we have totally forgotten our commission and calling. Question for you. Everybody thinks right now that they should be called to be a prophet, called to be a pastor, called to be an apostle, called to be a praise team leader, called to be a singer in the choir, called to children's ministry. There's so many callings right now. Show me in the Bible, in the New Testament, after Jesus Christ died, one person that God called to ministry, a ministry. Oh, wait. No, I'm serious. Give me one name. Can't say Paul, because he called Paul to salvation. And he had, Paul had an encounter with Christ that changed his life. I'm waiting. Show me in the New Testament where Jesus Christ or God called one person and said, you are called to prophesy. You are called to be a pastor. You are called to be the NYI president. But yet still, as Christians, our whole churches and bases of our Christianity is, God, what is my calling? I'm going to tell a quick story. So my son Malachi is going to college. Someone texted today, right? And they, you know, they, one of his godparents, mom, she's trying to find out how he's doing, what choices is he's making, and blah, blah, blah. And she ended the statement, you know, I'm praying for him and that God shows him where he's called to. And I had a real problem with that. To be honest, I didn't even reply because I've learned to shut my mouth when I disagree. Listen, I don't fight with people. I keep telling y'all, all these arguments that y'all getting into, stop, drop, and worship. Ooh, that's a t-shirt. Anytime you feel the need to argue with someone, stop, drop, and worship. Anytime somebody get it on your nerve, stop, drop, and worship. So I didn't respond, but here's why I didn't respond. Because I am learning as I am maturing in my spirituality with Christ, is that Christ called me to make disciples, baptize them, and to teach. I can do that wherever I go. I should be doing that wherever I go. Whatever space I occupy, whether it's the street corner or the store or the club, I should be in position to make disciples, baptize them, and teach the word of God. You see, I told y'all, like, places get really quiet when I preach. That's our calling. But we all are focused on, God, what am I supposed to do in my life? Where am I supposed to go? Where have you called me to? Who have you called me to marry? What job have you called me to have? How many children have you called me to have? How much money in the bank have you called? Like, everything is now a calling. Tell me I'm lying. When he didn't call one person in the New Testament after Jesus Christ was crucified, he called all who believed in him. All. This is an opinion. The downfall, the greatest downfall of the church is that we stopped making disciples, we stopped baptizing people, and we stopped teaching about Christ. Instead, we became institutions centralized in buildings, and the only way you can get into the building is if you knew the secret code. You have to say amen a certain way. You have to wear a certain length dress and look a certain way. You have to talk a certain way. You have to dance a certain way. You have to clap a certain way. And most importantly, you have to be able to pretend that you don't sin. Yeah, y'all could just say ouch. And if you could do those things, you become acceptable. And there's a lot of acceptable Christians in the pew, but not in the streets. Final point. Yeah. Nah, I gotta go. Y'all gonna get me stoned. Here's what I love about Samuel. I'm always calling my children for stuff, and they're mad annoyed with me all the time. They'll tell you. See, she's shaking her head. I call them to come take my dishes downstairs. To get me something from downstairs that I need upstairs because I ain't walking down the steps. I call them to turn my AC on and off, to turn my light on and off if I needed to. I call them. Listen, I'm Caribbean in some ways. So I birth you so that I can call you. I agree. Notice they're not clapping. But here's why I love Samuel as I close. Dang, I preached long. Samuel, when he heard the call, his response is what gets me each and every time. He moved. Every single time Samuel heard the call, Samuel moved. I was tempted to name the song Move, Get Out the Way, but you can tell my age, right? I didn't. But the concept still lives. Can I have six young men in the hole in this aisle right here? Just six. Just come. Line up. Six. Six are girls. It don't matter. I'm usually not as tall. Do we have six? Check the number. Listen, the teacher and me, I ain't helping y'all. I need six. Okay, so line up. Line up. Just go down. Line up. One behind the other. You come, sir. Right here. Just one behind the other. Space out. Yeah, space out. No, face me. Face me. There are times in life. Here's what I've learned and what I love about Samuel. This is what Samuel taught me. Every time God called Samuel, Samuel moved. But let's consider the circumstances in which Samuel might have been dealing with. Yes, Samuel moved, but it was at night. So that meant it was pitch dark at night. So as Samuel was moving at night, he might have been knocking over some stuff. Some stumbling blocks might have gotten in his way. He might have tripped over some stuff. Some stuff might have been placed to stop him and to hinder him in the process. But here is what I love about Samuel. Samuel didn't let anything that stood in his way prevent him from moving. Samuel looked down and saw that God was on the other side, or what he needed was on the other side. So Samuel went, look, drugs, I really can't mess with you right now. I need you to move out my way because I gotta get to God. Hey, pretty girl or boy, listen, I don't got time for the sexual temptation and pressure right now that the world is putting on me. So I'm gonna need you, sexual desire. You may look good, you may feel good, oh my God, but I'm gonna need you to move out my way. Listen, depression.
To you.
The thing I loved about Samuel is that he kept moving. And whatever got in his way, he moved it. And he kept answering the call. He kept responding to the call. But the call wasn't to be a prophet. The call was to relationship with Christ. The call was to the ability to hear God's voice for yourself. The call was to be able to get an insight into the mind and the heart of the God you serve. Can we play that song? Travis Green has this song, and it's simply called The Response.
Respond. I'm right here.
And all he's saying to God is, God, I'm right here.
You sit high, still you're looking for somewhere you could abide.
And I'm right here, God.
Three, two,